I want to say thank you for coming from the Nut. I really appreciate you guys coming out to our event. I know that part of the draw was that we're not having any parents here, and I want to let you know that we have had some arguments at the door, some parents wanted to come in, but we made sure that we kept the age limit. We made sure that we kept our promise to you, which is to make sure you guys have the privacy and the honor of being able to have your own talk, your own session, without a lot of opposing aunties here from the Nut. I'm going to be really briefly talking about a couple of things. Sister Janine is going to be giving us a lot of really, really good practical advice from her experience as a social worker. I'm going to be giving you a lot of experience and advice from being a son. Now, all of you over here and all of you over here, we're all children of people. We're all someone's child, right? And some of us, we have brothers, some of us, we have sisters, but either way, we all have a mom and dad from the Nut. Now, my story, personally, is not the brightest. You might say that this guy, he gives football, this guy, Abraham Murphy, he is the youth director at a masjid. You know, he speaks here and there, he's, you know, whatever. You might see me in a certain image. But I want to tell you some stories about my past, my parents, right? I know this is on YouTube. I know my mom is watching right now. But I want to tell you guys, just to give you an idea of where I came from. My parents and I had a very interesting past. And all the blame, now that I'm older, I see it on myself. When I was a kid, when I was younger, I'm still young, this is 23, remember that, but when I was younger, when I was your age, all of the problems, right, when we see a problem with our parents, who's the fault? Ours the parent. Louder, ours the parents. I always, 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 without fail, was convinced that my parents were the ones causing the problems. It's my mom who doesn't understand me. It's my dad who doesn't get me. It's my mom who won't listen to me, my dad who won't allow me to go hang out with my friends, and so on and so forth. And as I got older, I began to realize a couple things. And these realizations I'm going to share with you tonight. The first and foremost is that I sympathize with each and every one of you. I know what you're going through. And I'll be honest with you, even the guys and girls who are talking right now, as I'm talking, which is not very respectful, I don't appreciate that. I know that each and every one of you, the problems that you might have with your parents, or the problems that your friends have with your parents, I can tell you for a fact that I know that they're real. And I know that you guys are suffering from them. And I know that that's why you guys came here. Because you're looking for answers. Some speakers come up to the stage, and some speakers will say stuff like, "Oh, kids, you gotta be patient. You gotta be patient with your parents. You gotta love them and know what they do for you." And we agree, we have to be patient. Our parents love us more than anyone. But I agree with you guys, and I'm on your side. I know that the issues you're going through are real, and that's why we're having this in the first place. The second thing that I learned, the second realization that I made, is that a lot of us here in this room right now feel like no one else has gone through the problems that we've gone through. How many of you feel like that? Raise your hand. No one else has gone through the exact situations you have. Don't be shy, raise your hand. Keep it high. Okay, stand up if you feel this. One girl. We all feel like no one else, man, there's no one who can sympathize with my problems. My mom, the way she treats me, no one else's mom treats them that bad. Right? You tell me my mom, but I love her. And she's like, "Baby, you're 12. Right? "Dad, but I have to go to the mall with my friends. Justin Bieber's there, right? When in fact, it's just like one of the 8,000 white kids who looks just like Justin Bieber. Right? But never say never, I might be there. May Allah guide you first time. Never say that. So, we feel as if no one else has ever experienced our problems before. That we're unique, and we are unique, and maybe our problem is unique, but I'm promising you guys that your friends who you hang out with on weekends, your friends who you see at school, even your teachers, your social workers, your youth directors, even your imams, even prophets of Allah went through the same problems that you guys are going through. And prophets of Allah went through the same problems that your parents might be going through. Who knows a famous prophet who had a problem with his son? Starts with the Al and the Lut. Lut, very good. Okay, who knows of another prophet who had a problem with his dad? Starts with a I and Ibrahim. Ibrahim. So there are a lot of prophets in our religion. We feel sometimes like our religion, they can't relate to us. Like, we're from 2011, and our religion is from, like, 300 AD, and we're like, "Oh, okay, there's no way," right? My religion is from after the Promised Land, right? That's all it is, or biryani gulab jamun, that's it. But man, this religion, this deen of Islam, the reason why it's so beautiful is because no matter how far in time you're going to look back, or how far you're going to go forward, I know I just did back and forward, okay, back and forward, no matter how far either way, you'll see that Islam, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed it, it's always going to be relevant to you. It's always going to fit into your life. The question is, are you allowing it to fit into your life? The question is, do you allow Islam to come into your life? The question is not, is it going to help you? The question is, are you ready to help you? And so when we look at problems with our parents, I just named off the top of my head two MBA, two prophets that had problems with their family. There are many more. We have to look not only at Dr. Phil, at Oprah Winfrey, at Sister Janine, who's an amazing social worker, mashallah, not only for our friends. How many of us, when we have problems, we ask our friends for advice? Right? More girls than guys, actually, right? That's what we know. I play Call of Duty. We have to look to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the examples of our prophets, of our beloved Anbiya, especially Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because they taught us the way to get through problems in life. And again, it's a question of whether or not we're allowing it. It's not a question of whether or not it does. Three stories tonight. How many stories? Four. Very good. Okay. Three. Three stories tonight to prove to you that this deen makes sense, that this deen will help you with your problems with your parents, and the sister Jean is going to follow up with an amazing presentation. The first story, story number one, a man from Yemen. Many of you might have heard me tell this story, but wallahi, every time I tell it, there's new lessons. So listen closely. First story, a man from Yemen. He tells his mom, Ummi, my mother, I'm going to go visit the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I'm going to go try to go to Medina and go visit him. Because why? If you see the Prophet when you're alive and he dies a Muslim, what do they call you? A Sahabi. The definition of a companion. When we say, who are the companions of the Prophet? Who are the companions? There's two things. Number one, they saw the Prophet while they were alive and they died as a Muslim. Right? So this man, if you're a companion of the Prophet, it's a very big honor, right? When you meet a famous person, oh my God, I met Miles Austin. Right? Wouldn't you tell all your friends if Barack Obama was walking down the street, right? He was at Asra. They didn't pay me, that's right. So he's at Nunaway. Barack Obama's eating Nunaway. And you meet him, you're like, oh my God, it's Barack freaking Obama. And you're like, what's up, man? How's that first black president going? Alright? Yeah, I know. I feel you, even though you don't. You tell all your friends, you go home, Twitter, Facebook, instantly. OMG, you met Barack Obama, LOL, BRB, right? It's the same thing. The people, they wanted to meet the Prophet because he is the messenger of Allah. He's more famous than Barack Obama. He's closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so they're like, I want to meet the Prophet. I want to meet the Prophet. So this man was very excited. He went to his mother. He was younger, right? He was not like, oh, he was like 78, right? His mom's like, I'm 80. No. He was younger. And he said, oh, my mother, I want to meet the Prophet. And she goes, okay. And she goes, but I need you back by this date. How many of us tell our parents we want to go out? And they say, okay, but you got to be back by this time. Raise your hand. You ever had that before? Yeah, we've had it, right? And we usually don't show up. And so he goes, okay, I'll be back by this time. So this man, this Yemeni man, he goes to Medina. He travels. It's not a flight. He doesn't book a flight, right? He doesn't get like a 4-hour flight to Medina from Yemen. No. He rides on his camel and he walks on his feet. And he goes to Yemen. Or I'm sorry, he goes to Medina. He goes home. And he gets there. After months of traveling, he gets there. He knocks on the Prophet's door. And who answers? Who answers? No, Aisha. And Aisha says that the Prophet is not here. He went out on a caravan, and he won't be back for a while. Now remember, what did the Imam say to the man before he left? Be back by a certain time, right? And so he said, when is he going to be back? She says, he won't be back till this date. And in his mind, he goes, I can't stay here because I won't be able to get back to my mom in time, and she told me. This man wanted to meet the Prophet. We're trying to go meet our friends as the stars, and we're late to our parents. This guy was trying to be the messenger of God, and he went back. He left and said, okay, I won't make it in time, so I'm going to leave now. He heads back. to Yemen. And he goes back to his mother, and the story. The Prophet came back and they told him what happened. After weeks and weeks and months, they said, Ya Rasulullah, this man came. And he wanted to meet you, but his mother said that he needed to be back home, so he left. And the Prophet said, are you serious? And they said, yeah. And he told his companions, if you ever meet this guy, ask him to make dua with you, because his dua is going to be accepted by Allah, whatever he asks. Right. Did he even meet the Prophet? Yes or no? Yes or no? Who did he meet? They met Aisha, right? But who did he go back home to? His mom. So he obeyed his mother, even over meeting the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet said, any dua he makes, accepted. A plus. Right? Next story. Another man from Yemen. I have no idea what's up with the guy from Yemen. You're from Yemen? I'm sorry. Right? I'm okay. Yes, I'm sorry. Thank you. You feel my pain finally. So one guy from Yemen, he goes to meet the Prophet. Same kind of conditions, right? But this is different because he didn't leave his mother and father on good terms. He left his mother and father crying. So he gets to Medina and he meets all the companions, right? All the companions are sitting, and the Prophet is sitting. And he goes to his companions and he says, I came all the way from Yemen. I came all the way from Yemen. And I left my parents crying at the doorstep. They were weeping because I wanted to be a companion of the Prophet. Because I want to be close to you, Rasulullah. So the Prophet looks at him. And he says to the guy, he goes, tell me something. It's what you want, Jannah. How many of us want Jannah in this room? Raise your hand. Raise your hand. Don't think you're too cool to raise your hand, because if you get Jannah because you raise your hand, you'll thank me later. Right? And so the Prophet says, tell me something. I didn't say put your hands down. I'm kidding. He says, do you want Jannah? The guy goes, of course, Rasulullah. That's why I came to see you. I want to learn from you. I want to be close to you. I want to be like you. And the man said, if you really, really want to be in Jannah, go back to your parents and make them laugh, just like you left with them apart. Go back and live with your parents. SubhanAllah. The third story. Wallah, I'm not joking, another guy in Yemen. There was a big thing in Yemen, right? It's kind of like, you know, there was like a trend going on. So he takes his mother. This is after the death of the Prophet. His mother's very old. How many of you guys, your parents have been on Hajj? How many of y'all, you have been on Hajj yourself? MashaAllah. Allah allows all on Hajj, I mean. So this man, he goes to Hajj and his mother wanted to make Hajj. And so what he does is his mother's very old. And they didn't have wheelchairs back then. So what he does is he becomes the wheelchair. How do you become a wheelchair? You gotta carry your mom, right? How many of you guys are doing this? Did you guys carry your mom to the store? Yeah? MashaAllah, it's good. Good, no, seriously. I'm being serious, but no, we're laughing. Like, wait a minute. So he carried his mom all the way on foot. You guys believe that? On his feet, carried his mother to the Haram, to Hajj. And he went and he made the walk. And during the walk, he met a man named Abdullah ibn Omar. He was the son of Omar. Who was Omar? You guys know Omar was? Very close friend of the Prophet. He's a Prophet. He was one of his homies, right? The Prophet had homies, a lot of homies. We call them companions, but they're really homies. And he met Abdullah ibn Omar, and he said, Ya Abdullah! He goes, I carried my mom on my back all the way from Yemen because she wanted to do Hajj. He said, is this enough for me to pay her back? Pay her back for what? 9 months, amen? Birth. By the way, guys, I know you don't like know this, but birth is kind of painful. Look at it. Don't search it up on YouTube. You will not be able to see it. You cannot unsee something. Keep that in mind. He says, have I paid my mother back for the labor she put into me in building me from her own body? All the food she ate during when she was pregnant, it didn't just go to her, but to me too. Then the 9 months of raising me up in her womb and then birthing me, which is a painful process. They didn't have all these kind of medications like they do now. No, you gave birth to your kid in the house, right? Dr. Who? Not Dr. Seuss, Dr. Nobody, by yourself. And on top of that, raising the kid, right? Change a diaper, he poops his diaper. Change a diaper, he poops. What? Why is he pooping your diaper? Right? All that, till he's older, he carries his mother, and he says, have I paid my mother back for that time? I carried her for months to another country. Abdullah Omar says, wallahi, wallahi, you have not paid her back for 1 second that she spent in time for childbirth. Why am I telling you guys this? To make you all feel like crap? No. I'm telling you for one reason and one reason only. Before we talk about how to improve our relationship with anyone, with Allah, with our teachers, with our youth director, with our parents, we have to appreciate them first. You will never be able to respect someone unless you appreciate them. And that's true for anyone. If you don't appreciate Allah, you might find yourself missing prayers, and that's disrespectful. If you don't appreciate your teachers, you might find yourself talking in class, and that's disrespectful. If you don't appreciate your parents, you might find yourself disobeying them, and that's disrespectful. So if you ever want to develop a relationship that's respectful between you and your parents, you have to, number one, do what? Appreciate them. Very good. Now this is practical advice. We told those stories, but I want to tell you one more time. I feel for you guys. I know that sometimes the way your parents treat you is unfair. I admit it, 100%. Your parents, sometimes they make mistakes, and they treat you unfairly. Sometimes they give your brother the car keys and say, go have fun, and they tell you mistakes like do your homework. Sometimes they give your sister money, go ahead and buy brownies, and you can't get brownies. You're like, WTF, no brownies. Right? And then you go on, fail block, FML, no brownies. Right? We should start doing AFML, I'm doing that for my life. I love it. So I know your parents treat you unfairly sometimes. You know what? I admit it. In fact, I support it. No, I know. But I totally sympathize with you guys. But what I have to tell you here is that life is unfair. And you're going to have to deal with it. And I promise you, my mom and I know it's on YouTube, so it's kind of risky. My mom and I were butting heads. Because see, my mom's Egyptian. How many of you guys are Egyptian? So you know how moms are, right? My mom and I, we would literally butt heads. Not literally, that's like perpetual. Figuratively, we would butt heads. We would argue all the time. Until I got the job in Richardson. I got the job in March, and I left in April to move here from Chicago. Until, like, 2 weeks before I left, arguing, right? Because we both feel very strongly about what we want to do. I want to go out, and I'm supposed to stay in. I want all these things. Wallahi, asked my wife, the first night I was here in Dallas by myself, the first night I got freedom, that I had my own car, I had my own job, could have gone anywhere, I was laying on my living room floor crying like a baby, saying, I miss my mom. Called my wife. She goes, why are you crying? I miss my mom. I miss her. So my advice to you is one advice alone. Appreciate your parents before you lose them, whether you move or whether they pass away. Because that day is coming soon, a lot sooner than you think. And wallahi, when that day comes, you're going to remember. What's today's date? The 18th. You might not remember the date, but you'll remember the guy, me. And you'll remember that I told you to appreciate your parents. If they give you crap, take that crap. If they give you lemons, make lemonade. If they give you anything, say thank you and give them a hug. Because when they die, or when they leave you, or when you leave them, sometimes you won't be able to hug them anymore. And that's the worst pain you can ever feel in your entire life. So I know you guys are going through tough times. I know it's difficult. But number one is be patient. Number two is appreciate. And number three is always, always, always allow them to be the way they are and work with them. Work with them. Don't work against them. I know nowadays it's cool to go against your parents, right? This is what we're taught. Jersey Shore? Who met your parents, yo? GTL, right? You look at skins, you look at any of these shows, the cool thing is you go against your parents. Be your brother, right? You look at how Bart Simpson treats his dad Homer, right? Good father-son relationship or no? No, right? And then the sons who treat their dad well, Ned Flanders, his kids are good to the dad, right? They're like these nerdy kids, these nerdy lady kids, right? So I know that we're hearing in movies and music and television, go against your parents, but I'm telling you that the coolest person who ever existed, Wallahi, he's the coolest, the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He taught us that being good to your parents is one of the best things you can ever do. So no matter what anyone tells you, be good to your parents and appreciate them. Wallahi, if you appreciate them, they'll appreciate you back. All the unfairness, all the difficulties, they'll turn it off and they'll be cool with you. So appreciate your parents, show them hugs and kisses, tell them I love them, give them a text message, I love you, mom, right? LOL. Give them that, and I swear they'll show up back, inshallah. And with that, we're going to invite sisters to the stage, inshallah, after our blessed retreat from my own.